Studying urban areas and cities in the best part of 15 years, and in doing so, I've extensively explored many types of residential segregation. You already know what segregation is. We most commonly talk about segregation in terms of the place in which people live, but it could equally occur in our schools, our workplaces, or on modes of transport. In this session, we refer to segregation as a spatial separation between two or more groups. I bet for many of you, segregation associates with something negative. Maybe it's poverty or mistrust, perhaps separation or inequality. However, segregation need not be negative. Just imagine students living together in a halls of residence. These are highly segregated places. Only students can live in them. And the same would apply for elderly in care homes or for ethnic minority groups who want to have access to specialised services or shops or religious infrastructure. Okay. So you know what segregation is, but how do we go about measuring it? Well, you'd think it should be fairly straightforward, but actually it isn't. There are lots of different ways to think about the type of segregation and ways to measure it. Back in the 1980s, two American researchers, Douglas Massey and Nancy Denton, wrote a paper exploring the 20 most commonly used measures and how they were related to each other. From their analysis, they proposed five distinct dimensions: evenness, exposure, clustering, concentration, and centralization. Of these, I suggest that evenness is the most important, as it's the dimension that leads to all the others. If a group is evenly distributed, then there will be no segregation in any of the other dimensions. So how do we measure evenness? Well, the most commonly used index is the index of dissimilarity. In theory, it can range from 0 to 1. Although you will sometimes see it reported as a percentage ranging from 0 to 100. The minimum value of 0 can be interpreted as there being no segregation at all, and each neighborhood having exactly the same composition of the two groups as the overall city, a value that is very unlikely to occur. Equally unlikely is a value of 1, which would mean that there is complete and total separation between the two groups. When you do calculate the index of dissimilarity, you obtain a value of above 0, which refers to the proportion of the population in the minority group who would have to move neighbourhood in order to achieve an equal distribution of the group across all neighbourhoods in the city. The higher the number, the more people who would have to move, and the higher the level of segregation. So calculating some indices for cities should be fairly straightforward, shouldn't it? Now, hold on a minute. There's one important issue which has a strong effect on how you measure segregation. It is how we define the neighbourhood. Think for a moment about your neighbourhood. You can imagine how big it is, and you can imagine how far it extends around you. But the problem here is that if you asked your neighbour the same question about the same neighbourhood, they may well have a completely different answer. And neither of the answers you had or your neighbour had are in line with the official bureaucratic boundaries of the neighbourhoods that we have in our data. But even if you could agree on the size of the neighbourhood, there's still an infinite number of ways to divide a city up. In the literature, this is called the modifiable area unit problem, or MORP. This is very important because the result of the calculation of the index of dissimilarity, or indeed any other index, depends on how you define the neighbourhoods in your data. If you increase or decrease the size of the neighbourhood, or you change the boundaries where they lie, then the value of your index calculation will also change. So, if you want to study changes in segregation over time in a city, then it's really important to keep the same definitions of neighbourhood. And it is important to acknowledge that the measure of segregation is only valid for the geography that you've been able to use. It is even better to calculate measures for segregation for different definitions of neighbourhood at the same time, so you can assess the effects of the definitions that you've used. By reporting different measures for different geographies, you're being honest about the choices that you've made and the effects these choices have on the measured level of segregation. We often observe, for instance, that smaller areas are more homogeneous, and as a result, segregation measures calculated with small neighbourhoods are higher than in larger, more heterogeneous neighbourhoods. This may be because there's less segregation, or it may be because the scale we have defined the neighbourhood at has influenced our results. Either way, using a multi-scale approach to segregation is crucial for developing urban design solutions, as processes play at the regional, the urban, the city, and the neighbourhood scale.